Good morning, everyone. Welcome to First Assembly. We're glad that you are here today and we're here to worship the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Will you join me in rejoicing in the Lord today? Amen. We're going to give Him praise. We're going to just come together in honor of Him today, worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth. So if you will, why don't you stand as we receive the word that Sister Bercy is coming right now.
From Isaiah 26, beginning with verse 3 and ending in verse 8. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for in Yah, the Lord, is everlasting strength. For he brings down those who dwell on high. The lofty city, he lays it low. He lays it low to the ground. He brings it down to the dust. The foot shall tread it down, the feet of the poor and the steps of the needy. The way of the just is uprightness. Oh, most upright, you weigh the path of the just. Yes, in the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you. The desire of our soul is for your name and for the remembrance of you.
Yeah. us from our sins, and I thank you for his blood this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me. Stands in my defense. Jesus is your blood. Everybody sing that this morning. Sing it with us. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty names I've heard upon this earth. Such righteousness for me. Jesus, it's your blood.
Are you thankful for the blood this morning?
Oh,
Come together in his name, and this morning we have many that are in need of a touch from God today. And let me just tell you this morning that as all of the things that have been happening over the last few days, weeks, and now months, I feel like the Lord has impressed me that what the body of Christ needs to do during this pandemic, during this time where things are seemingly getting worse. In fact, this morning I've gotten word of two of our sister churches here in the Pensacola area that have once again closed their doors for public services in the church building. That's happening. I believe that we have enough space here in the sanctuary that we can safely distance ourselves and be okay. But in the midst of all of this, I addressed this about not having fear, that we would not be afraid in the midst of all of this. I talked a lot about how that we needed to walk in faith and so forth, but that we needed to also walk in wisdom. But this morning, I feel like the Lord has dropped a word in my heart that I believe is a right now word. And what we must do in the days ahead, I want you to listen very closely. We must praise our way through all of this. We must praise our way to victory. I believe that's the word the Lord has for us this morning. I want us to hear clearly that no matter how rough it gets, no matter how many reports that we hear that could cause us great, great concern, in the midst of it all, we must not allow the devil to take our praise from us. We must continue to praise the Lord. We don't praise God for the trial that comes. We don't praise God for the things that are tough and rough. We praise God in them, in the midst of them. Hallelujah. I don't want us to get up in the morning and find our tire is flat on the car and say, "Praise God, my tire is flat." That's not the extreme that I'm talking about. That's not at all what I'm talking about. I'm talking about that even if you have a positive test result, you will say, "Praise God, God is still my healer. God is still the strength of my life. He will keep me in perfect peace because my mind is stayed on Him." Hallelujah. Amen. Now, I was going to preach a whole sermon on this, and then I realized that this needs to be a part of a series of sermons. And that is called the Ministries of the Church. So that's where I want to go this morning. Today will be part one of a series on the ministries of the church. We're going to start with Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 11, and we will read through verse 16. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 through 16. Are you with me? All right. "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ." Now I'm reading from the New King James Version, and it appears that on the screen it is the King James Version, so there's just a little difference. But hear the word of the Lord this morning. So listen to verse 12 again. for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. We're going to be talking about the ministries of the church. God gives gifts in the body for the equipping of saints. We need to be equipped. Amen. We don't need to go out empty-handed. And most of all, not empty-headed. Hallelujah. We need to hear the word of the Lord, and we need to be equipped. When you are equipped, that means you have what you need to do the job that is set before you. Just think, my dad was a brick mason. If he had gone to lay brick, they had the brick, they had the mortar, they had the scaffolding, they had everything else, but he didn't have a trowel. If he didn't have a trowel, he didn't have any way to pick up the mortar and spread it so he could put the bricks in place. He would have come to the job unequipped. Many of us go unequipped, and yet there is an equipping of the saints that can take place right here, because this morning, I want us to understand, right here where we are is the classroom of the Holy Spirit. This is the classroom of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our teacher, and He will teach us, and He will guide us, and He will equip us. And I want to be His servant, and I want to be used in His hand to be able to give to you what He gives to me to help to equip you, as I am your pastor, and that is one of the gifts that is given to the church. So let's go back to verse 12 again. Those gifts that were given for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. We need to come to where we are united in faith. That is, that we know what we believe and that we all are agreeing together on what we believe. That we believe the same things. That we are saying the same things. We are not going in different directions with different tangents, but that we have come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man or a mature man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up. Everybody say, grow up. Now, I'm not going to tell you to look at your neighbor and say, grow up. Surely, I think I saw you look at Cindy and say, grow up. All right? So look at yourself and say, grow up. We are children of God, yes, but we are not always to act as children. We are to be mature. Hallelujah. All right. So we're not tossed to and here and there, but we're speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ. We are growing up into Him, into Christ. Verse 16, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. The growth of the body is talking about the growth of the church body. That we as a church body will grow for the edifying or the building up of itself. And the last two words are these: in love. Let us remember that everything must be done and said in love. Remember what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I am what? I am become like a clanging cymbal and a tinkling brass. In other words, I'm meaningless. And he said, though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, it profits me nothing. Listen this morning, everything that we do as a church body needs to be done in love. God is love. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Jesus loves the church. You will come in contact with people who will tell you, I used to be a part of the church, but I'm not into church any longer. I got a new neighbor who's moved in next door to me, and I spoke to them and I invited them to church. And he said, we're not religious. I wanted to say, neither am I. But I thought that would really confuse the whole situation. So I didn't go there. I'm not religious. I believe in relationship with Jesus. It is his church. It belongs to him. He shed his blood for all who would believe so that his church might be established. Now understand this morning what I'm doing is giving you a quick overview of where we're going to be going through these next few weeks as we talk about the ministries of the church. In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18, Jesus said as he was talking to Peter, I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock, not on Peter, but on the rock of the declaration of who Christ is, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. This is the first mention of the word church in the Bible. Matthew chapter 16 verse 18 is the first mention. And many times there is a lot of significance in the time that a name or a particular word is introduced. It's the first time it appears in the scriptures. Jesus said, upon this rock or upon the declaration that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, the word church comes from a Greek word that is ekklesia. You hear about the word ecclesiastical. It comes from the same root word. The only other use of the word in the Gospels is in Matthew chapter 18 and verse 17, where Jesus is giving instruction on resolving conflict with a brother in the church, where he tells you that if you will go to your brother privately first, and if he doesn't hear you, take somebody with you and go back to him. If he still doesn't hear you, then bring it to the church. And then the church will deal with it. And if he doesn't hear the church, then you will basically excommunicate him and you will treat him as though he is an outsider completely. Now, when we come to the book of Acts, we find a whole lot of mention of the word church. And the first place that we find it is in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, verses 46 and 47. And it says this: "So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved." The Lord added to the church. How is the church being built? The Lord is building his church. One block at a time, one soul at a time, the Lord was adding to the church those who were being saved. And that, when was it done? Added to the church when? Every Sunday? Daily. I wonder this morning, are there being people added to the church every day? Huh? We barely see anybody added to the church on Sunday. What's happening on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday? The word needs to still be going out, and we still need to be reaching out to people who are lost so that people could be added to the church daily. Now, in this series of messages, I want to explore in detail what I will continue, or I will outline this morning. So we will talk about, first of all, our ministry to the Lord. To the Lord, there is a ministry that goes upward. Before you start your ministry horizontally, you need to start your ministry vertically. We minister to the Lord. How do we do that? We minister to the Lord in worship. And then I want to talk about our ministry to one another in the body of Christ. There is a ministry that needs to be taking place in the body, one to another. We as the church body need to be ministering to one another. And then the ministry in evangelizing the world. And lastly, our ministry of compassion to those who are less fortunate than us, that we can reach out to in love so that we can help those who are down and out. Now, this morning, as we're looking at this overview, first of all, I want to look at our ministry to the Lord in worship. There are some questions that come to mind. What does worship really mean? Another question is it necessary to sing in order to worship? How does praise fit into worship? How can our worship be misdirected? What about the gifts of the Spirit in worship? These are some questions that come to mind that I want to explore with you over the next week or so. In John chapter 4, verse 24, Jesus is talking to the woman at the well, and he says to her, "God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit," and that spirit is not capitalized. It's talking about your spirit. We must worship out of our spirit, but we also must worship in truth. Hallelujah. This morning I want us to understand that we have not truly worshiped the Lord until it has come from out of here, from out of our innermost being. You may raise your hands, you may clap your hands, you may do all the motions outwardly, but if your worship is not coming from inside your heart, it is not true worship. And then it must be done in truth, which means according to the Word of God, according to the Scriptures. Psalm 34 in verse 1, it says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Hallelujah. So listen to me. As we are going through all of this, as I've already said, we're going to praise our way through the midst of all that we're going through. Don't give up your praise. Let it be continual, not just at church. Continual. When you're riding down the road, praise the Lord. You ride up and stop at a stoplight. And you're just praising the Lord. Somebody next to you looks over and wonders what in the world's going on. You know what? That's all right. I've pulled up by a many a car that's going boom, 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 boom. You understand what I'm saying? They want me to know where they are. Hallelujah. I'm not afraid to praise the Lord in the midst of it all. Glory to God. Let your praise be continual. The battle is the Lord's. The praisers led the way into battle, and the Lord made a way where there was no way. He confused the enemy, and praise God, the victory was theirs. Then we're going to talk about our ministry to one another in the body. Here are some questions. What is my responsibility toward ministering to my brother? How can I develop a sensitivity to those who are hurting and need encouragement? Don't you think you'd like to have that question addressed? How do I speak those words and do it not out of obligation, but with love and compassion and being genuine? People can tell when you're just going through the motion. It needs to be genuine. Amen. What does the Bible say about ministering to one another? Well, let's go back to Ephesians chapter 4 for a minute, and let's go down to verse 29. It says, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Doesn't that sound like a good way to treat one another? All right. Now, here's another part of ministering to one another. And I think this is so very, very important. I want you to hear it this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, Paul says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort. He is God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. When you've gone through something, it may not be that it's just for you. God may have allowed you to go through something so that when you come out on the other side, you will know better how to minister to someone who's going through what you've been through. So that we can speak words of comfort, words of encouragement, words of edification, words to help lift them up. There are people who are dragging the bottom this morning. There are people who are so discouraged they don't know what to do. And this is the time for the church to rise up and be the one who can speak a word of hope, a word of comfort, a word of help. Amen. If you don't have amens, I brought some with me. Hallelujah. Thirdly, our ministry in evangelizing the world. What is my responsibility in reaching the lost? Do I have a responsibility? How can I develop a sensitivity of the leading of the Spirit in witnessing? And now I want to go to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Most of us can probably quote it, but I'm going to read it. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. You're going to be my witnesses. You're going to go out and tell what's happened. Read the book of Acts, and you will find Paul, who was Saul of Tarsus, one of the greatest conversion stories in the Bible. And you might say, well, nobody was witnessing to him. Oh, yes, they did. He wasn't on the scene whenever Paul gave his life to Christ, but the seed had already been planted. Because when Stephen was being stoned to death, it was Saul of Tarsus who was standing there and holding the clothes of the ones who were stoning him. He watched him. He listened to him. He heard his witness. He heard him say, I see the heavens open. I see the Son of God standing at the Father's right hand. Hallelujah. What a testimony that had come, and it made such an impact upon Saul of Tarsus. He could not get away from it. And the more he went to get the Christians and try to kill them, the Holy Spirit was on his trail. And when he was on his way to Damascus, he had an encounter with God. Now he is brought before kings and many other people. And what does he do? He recounts his testimony. He tells how Jesus arrested him, how he came to know Christ. Thank God this morning that we can be witnesses. Look at Mark chapter 16 and verse 15. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Preach the gospel. What are we going to preach? The gospel. What is the gospel? Good news. Are you spreading good news? Amen. Isn't it time that the church spread good news? Have you turned on Fox News lately? Have you turned on CNN? Have you turned on ABC, NBC, and all of the others? I'll tell you what you're going to hear. bad news. You're going to hear how our world is torn apart, how it's being ravaged. Things are happening I would never have thought I would ever live to see it happen. But it's happening, and they're showing it on our television screens. And if you sit in front of Fox News all day, God help you. The next place you're going to need is an insane asylum. Amen. There's too much bad news. Hallelujah. My grandson has been with me this week, and he likes to look at other things besides the news. And so I have looked at very little news this week. I've seen all kinds of things this week. Hallelujah. He plays all those video games and all those kinds of things on the TV screen. And I wouldn't know how to start to do that kind of stuff. Good news. What is the good news? Jesus saves. Jesus heals. Jesus delivers. Jesus sets free. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the reason that we are here today. Thank God there is something to talk about that is good. He lifted me up. He saved me. He encouraged me. I walk in victory. Hallelujah. I'm not in defeat. Hallelujah. I'm going to get happy whether you do or not. Matthew chapter 28. These are some of the last words that Jesus spoke to his disciples before he went away. Verse 19 and 20. Go therefore. What did the other verse in Mark say? It said go. There's a go. I've heard people testify and say, God put a go ye in my heart. He spoke to me and said, go. Hallelujah. You know what? We ought to be sitting on G waiting for O. Go. At the first word, go. There's somebody in need. Go. There's somebody who needs salvation. Go. There's somebody who needs healing. Go. 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 Well, I can't because of the virus. Well, you can't spread virus through the telephone. You can't spread the virus through social media. Now, there's some viruses out there in social media. Amen. I'll tell you that for sure. You need to be careful with those viruses. Some of them are worse than the COVID-19. But you can go and fulfill what he's saying. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Somebody said, Pastor, I wish you would preach more than you would teach. Well, you look into the Word of God and you find that Jesus did more teaching than he did preaching. Always he was teaching, even in the Sermon on the Mount. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus was teaching on the Sermon on the Mount. Teaching, we need teaching. But if we get teaching and 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 we don't apply it, what good has the teaching done? The hour is growing late. Many in the world today believe that something catastrophic is going to happen. They don't know what it is. But they've got their eyes open. And they're expecting something really bad to happen. When is the next shoe going to drop? Let me tell you. There's just little things that are out there right now that you need to have your eyes open and you need to be aware of. Have any of you seen signs up in front of cash registers this week that says there's a shortage of coins in the United States right now? Huh? That is not by coincidence. Get ready. Get ready. The whole money system is going to change. Get ready. Mark my word, there will come a day when your dollars, your $100 bills or whatever, will be completely worthless. And there will be a new money that will be issued, or we will go completely to a cashless society. Get ready. Things are shaping up all the time for the mark of the beast. Am I fixing to tell you that the mark of the beast is about to be instituted? No, because I believe that we're going to leave this world before the mark of the beast takes place. I believe the rapture of the church is going to happen first. But I don't think that all of a sudden when the rapture takes place that they're going to start working feverishly to get everything in place to be able to get that part of the thing to work. They will have already have everything in place. Things are already being set in order for all of that to take place, friends. I want you to know we're living on the verge of the coming of Jesus. I can't say it enough. Jesus is coming. And he could come before we come to another worship service. We may not have to worry about whether we need to comply with the latest ordinance or not about closing the doors of the church. We may not be here to unlock it. Praise God. We're going to be gone in the twinkling of an eye. Jesus is coming. Hallelujah. But I want to ask you, how many friends and family do you have that are not ready to go? Are you doing all that you can to lead them to Christ? The time is short. Lastly, we're going to be talking about our ministry of compassion to those less fortunate. I want to read a passage out of Matthew chapter 25. You can turn back if you were just with me in Matthew 28. Matthew chapter 25, beginning with verse 37. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. When you reached out to those who were hungry, when you reached out to those who were in prison, when you reached out to those who were needy, you did it unto him. I learned something a long time ago. When you feel led of the Lord to give something to someone. It may be even a panhandler on the street. But you feel the leading of the Lord that you're to give to that person. When you give, release it. Don't worry about what they do with it. Because when you give it out of love and compassion and concern, and you're doing it as unto the Lord, they may misuse it and abuse it, but you have done it as unto God, and God is the one who will bless you. You don't give to the down and outer expecting to receive something from them in return. You give to them and you know that the reward that comes is from the Lord above and it's not from here below. So give as unto God. Hallelujah. We've been teaching in the book of James, and I'm getting ready to close. This scripture and one more. James chapter 1, we talked about this, but I want to bring it here this morning. James chapter 1, verse 27. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Lastly, this morning I'm closing by taking you to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 58. My dad spent his last birthday in this world at my house. And while he was visiting with me that week, several times he mentioned Isaiah chapter 58 to me. The night he went to be with Jesus, he was in church. And he had just stood up and testified. Sat down and had a massive heart attack and went to heaven just like that. Never knew what hit him. The Bible, his Bible, was open to Isaiah 58. And these passages stood out to me. Beginning with verse 6. Through verse 12. Listen. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness? To undo the heavy burdens? To let the oppressed go free? And that you break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry? And that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out? When you see the naked, that you cover him and not hide yourself from your own flesh? Then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. Don't you want the Lord to answer when you call? You shall cry, and he will say, "Here I am." If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing of the finger and speaking wickedness, if you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn in the darkness. And your darkness shall be as the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations, and you shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. I think that word speaks for itself. I don't have to expound upon it. Just listen to what the word said. He said, if you will do these things, then when you pray, your prayers will be answered. We need to examine what may be hindering our prayers. Father, I pray this morning that this word that you so strongly laid upon my heart, Lord, I pray that it shall find its place in our hearts today. And Lord, I know that many of the things that I have spoken are reminders of things that we have said in the past. But Lord, there's times that we need to be reminded. We need to remember. God, I just ask you to help us to be the church that you desire us to be. And that we are doing the things that you called us to do. We're doing the things that are important. Lord, that we may learn to major on the main things and not on the minor things. Because Lord, if we're not careful, we get consumed with things that are not the most important things, but they take our attention and they require us to respond. And Lord, I pray that in doing that, we do not neglect the main mission of the church. That we do not neglect the very thing that you've called us to do. Help us not to become so busy with busyness that we are too busy to hear your voice speaking into our hearts and leading us in these last days that we're living in. Lord, I believe this morning that your word is true and that the signs are showing us very clearly that it can't be long until you will come, and we want to be ready to meet you, Lord. Help us as a church body to be ready, but help us also to get the word to those who need you today, that they will also come to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, amen. Do you have something you want us to sing together?
I'll say yes, Lord. I'll say yes to your will, Lord. Where you lead me. whatever you want me to do.
You say yes to him this morning. Lord, where you lead me, I will go. Lord, I will say yes to your will. I want to be used in your hand to reach a world that's lost, to reach people who are hurting, to reach out in love and compassion. Hallelujah. I want you to stand with me. I'm going to pray a prayer of blessing before we go this morning. Father, I pray your blessing upon this congregation today. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that each person will be especially blessed by you. Each home that is represented here today will be blessed by you. Lord, guide our steps. Lead us in the paths of righteousness. Lead us into those places that you have appointed for us this week. God, I ask you that we will be the church that you would have us to be. Bless each one who has said in his heart today, I'll say yes. Lord, I'll go. I'll do what you would have me to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you go.